All right, Mr. D, herbicide mode of action. You know, we always tell folks they can use herbicides to kill some of these broadleaf weeds or grasses or whatever the case may be, but how do they actually work?
It's interesting. Mode of action, sites of action are a couple of terms that are used interchangeably. The site of action is the biochemical site where the actual herbicide does its thing. And different modes of action, different herbicides, some examples of some of the sites of actions some of the herbicides will prevent an enzyme from occurring, which is necessary for the plant to develop. Some of the herbicides will disrupt cell membranes and cause the cells to just explode and leak out. And I can give you some examples of some of these. Some of the more common herbicides are growth regulators, and they actually cause the plants to grow themselves to death. 2,4-D, dicamba are examples of that. Roundup, glyphosate is an amino acid. In aromatic amino acid inhibitor, which inhibits a certain amino acid that's necessary for the plant to develop and grow. And let me give you a few more. I'm going to have to look at my notes. There are what 20 over 20 different groups of. Different sites of action or modes of action, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but some of the more common ones, I've already mentioned the aromatic amino acid inhibitors, glyphosate, and there's root growth inhibitors, which is real common with pre-emergent herbicides, which actually prevents the roots from growing and prevents cell division from occurring within the root,
That's like pendimethalin, those type.
Right. There are photosynthesis inhibitors. Paraquat is an example of a photosystem one type. You know, it inhibits a certain part of photosynthesis. There's a photosystem two, also photosynthetic inhibitors that can keep plants from growing and developing. And the reason that it is so important to understand a little bit about modes of actions and site of actions is because a few years ago we encountered a phenomenon called weed resistant or herbicide resistant weeds.
I knew you were going to say it.
and probably the first one that I'm aware of was Roundup or glyphosate. When the glyphosate tolerant technology first became available in the mid to late 90s, it was just an outstanding, and still is, it's a great tool for farmers to use. But for several years, farmers would spray their crops with Roundup and it would kill every weed out there and leave the desirable crop there. And doing that year after year, what happened is every once in a while, a weed would survive that, you know, dose of Roundup or glyphosate. And, you know, some of these pigweed, and that's one of the real common ones that's resistant to glyphosate, a female pigweed plant can produce from between 800,000 to 1.2 million seeds.
Good night.
And that's one plant.
That's one plant, right.
And that plant, if it's resistant, if that one plant survives and it's resistant to this herbicide, then maybe not all of its offspring.
Right.
Will be resistant, but probably quite a few of them will be resistant. And you can see how very quickly you can start to have problems. So it's important to mix your herbicide modes of action up. And you can do that in several different ways. I mean, you can do it by crop rotation, because some herbicides are labeled for use on some crops and they're not labeled for use on other crops. And to give you an example, there are several products you can use on corn, sweet corn, that you can't use on beans, snap beans and peas. So if you have a broadleaf problem showing up in your beans and peas, which are also broadleaf, next year plant sweet corn in that spot and use a herbicide that kills all broadleafs.
Right.
And so that will help. And then plant your beans where you had sweet corn last year, and you can take out some of the grasses, because many of the herbicides that kill grasses will also kill corn, because
right.
corn is a grass.
It's a grass. Right.
And but so it's important not to, the main thing you need to take from this is don't use the same product over and over and over and over again in the same spot over and over and over again, because if you do, you're asking for herbicide-resistant weeds.
But is that a big concern for homeowners, though? You know, if they're going out with glyphosate Roundup just to kill some weeds in their driveway or something like that in their flower beds.
Probably not as much for herbicides, but
yeah.
when you get into insects,
yeah.
insect control, and maybe fungicide,
yeah.
you know, there are different modes of action there, and I understand we'll talk about that maybe another time. It may be more important, but if you reach the point, if you've been using a product for a long time and you start to notice that it's not working as good as it used to, mm-hmm. then that would, even in a home situation, that would tell me that I needed to do something different, use something different. And there are other products out there. An example, in a home situation to kill grasses, Roundup. It's known,
right.
known to kill grasses. Mm-hmm. If you run into a problem where Roundup's not doing as good a job as it used to, try post or fusillade
yeah.
or, you know, one of the sathoctidem or
fluazaflop.
There you
yeah.
are,
yeah.
which is the fusillade.
Right.
Use that, and that's a totally different mode of action, and it might give you a little bit better, you know, control. And
Wow.
Pays to mix things up a little bit. Mm-hmm.